Biden, let me just say this. It is truly historic, truly special for this president to have designated Camp Hale Continental Divide as America's newest national monument and to make the decision to do it here in this treasured landscape. Mr. President, we thank you. Eagle County, you can do better than that. Let's give a round of applause to the President of the United States. I could not be more thrilled to be here today on this historic day. We know that it would not be possible were it not for the tireless advocacy of the veterans of the 10th Mountain Division. There are many of whom are here today, their families. You heard the governor talk about one in particular veteran who's no longer with us, Sandy Treat. I believe Sandy Treat Jr. is here. If he is, I hope he'll stand, he'll raise his hand. Take a stand, Sandy Treat Jr. When I first began serving in Congress, I had the special opportunity to tour these grounds with Sandy, a World War II veteran who trained at Camp Hale and spent his final years working to preserve this land. And Sandy once wrote, "I grew up in an America, that valued our wild lands. And this is a value that I hope lives on long after I'm gone. Today, we made good. The president made good. Senator Bennett and Senator Hickenlooper and Governor Polis made good on the promise to Sandy that this land is valued and the service of the 10th Mountain Division will never, never be forgotten. I am so proud that after championing the protection of this area with Senator Bennett, who has been tireless for a decade working to get this done, that we can now honor the legacy of Sandy and the 10th Mountain Division, and that this will now be a reality. And finally, let me just say a special thank you to all of you who are gathered here today. Mr. President, before you, you have hundreds of county commissioners, of local ranchers, of conservationists, of veterans, of folks who treasure our public lands, who have spent a great deal of time and effort making this possible, beating the drum month after month, year after year, decade after decade. We are in your debt. We thank you, and we thank you, Mr. President. Today is indeed a special day. With that, I hope you'll join me in giving a warm applause to someone who needs no introduction. He, of course, is our former governor, with whom I had the pleasure of working for years ago, and now is our state's junior senator, but is doing one heck of a job in the United States Senate. Let's give it up for Senator John Hickenlooper.
And I'm so close to the main attractions that I'm going to be very brief, but I want to recognize Joe Nagusin. As always, he kind of hit the nail on the head. There can be no greater privilege than to have a mentor who's 10 years younger than you are, such as Michael Bennett. There he is. I'm not saying he's not a little sneaky in terms of his geography sometimes. I was enlisted back when I was governor. Michael Bennett came to me and started talking to me about the CORE Act and how relentless the whole community had been. And it was bipartisan. We had Republican commissioners, Democrat commissioners. We had people from all walks of life that were unified that these lands should be protected. And that we got a hearing in the Natural Resources Committee in the Senate. That CORE Act is not going anywhere. We're going to get it done in this coming year. But again, I give Michael the great credit to say, all right, well, if we're not going to get it done in the near term, when time is of the essence, where people and their families have been working so long to make this happen, to make this Continental Divide National Monument a reality, well, then why wait? Why don't we recognize that we can protect this land by making it a monument, by making it a reality, and allow us to move forward and have an event like this? And Secretary Vilsack, who certainly is one of the hardest working cabinet members I've ever known, in for two presidents, not just one, but for two presidents, and he hit it the other nail on the head. I think we've recognized that President Biden, really alone since Teddy Roosevelt, has come to the West and spent time in the West and recognized that we are unique and special out here and deserve that attention, and we appreciate it. So now I think I've thanked almost everybody, but I haven't thanked all the staff of Senator Bennett. I did not thank Governor Polis. I should mention that as one governor to the next, no greater benefit can you have in life than to have the next governor come along and be better than you were. And that is a gift, because he covers up all the mistakes you made by doing so many good things in his own right. Anyway, his staff, I want to recognize Governor Polis's staff. I want to recognize Senator Bennett's staff, Secretary Vilsack's staff, all of the Forest Service people, but especially the staff of the White House, who have worked so hard to make this as well a reality as well. And thank you all of you who really made it happen. Thank you. All right. Now I have thanked everybody, and I will ignore any speeches that they may have written for me and introduce someone who needs no introduction, truly needs no introduction, someone who's been working on these lands and this vision for more than a decade, your senior senator from Colorado, Michael Bennett.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. This is a historic day for Colorado, and I want to thank Senator Hickenlooper and Governor Polis, Congressman DeGoose, Secretary Vilsack. Thank you for coming back again and again and again. And I also would like you to give a round of applause to my staff, too, for the work that they've done over the years for this. And so many of you that are here for your leadership, making it possible. And Mr. President, welcome to Camp Hale. Welcome to Colorado. If I do say so myself, and perhaps speaking for myself, you have excellent taste, Mr. President, for your administration's first national monument designation. Your designation means more Americans will come to appreciate the extraordinary history of this place, a history that goes back to before when Colorado was a state. According to the Ute people, their ancestors lived here since the beginning of time. The Ute came to this place each year after the winter snow melted to hunt and gather plants for food and medicine. This designation honors their enduring connection to the land and their rightful role to help manage it. It also honors the singular legacy, as we've heard, of the 10th Mountain Division. A number of years ago, I came here to learn from 10th Mountain veterans about their experiences at Camp Hale. They joined 15,000 recruits who arrived here by train starting in 1942, not just from Colorado, but all across the country. Some had never seen snow before. Others had never been in the mountains. But among them were the best skiers and mountaineers and mountain climbers in America, and they learned from each other. Over the next 2 years, they trained relentlessly. In 10 feet of snow and temperatures 50 degrees below zero. 2 days ago, Mr. President, the son of a 10th Mountain vet told me his dad said this mountain was the coldest son of a bitch he ever climbed. The conditions were so tough, some called it Camp Hell, but it forged them into the world's most capable mountain soldiers, and they were just in time. By early 1945, the Allies had hit a wall in northern Italy where German soldiers held the high ground in the Apennine Mountains. Every Allied effort to break the German line had failed until the 10th Mountain Division arrived. At Riva Ridge, 10th Mountain soldiers climbed more than 1,800 feet straight up a vertical cliff with 90-pound packs and rifles in the dead of night. At dawn, they surprised the Germans, who believed their position was unassailable. Not for the 10th Mountain Division. They seized it. They scaled Mount Belvedere and punched a hole in the German line. And over the next 10 weeks, they pushed north with the Allies and helped clear the way for victory in Europe. All of this came at a terrible cost. Over 114 days of combat, more than 4,000 soldiers were wounded, nearly 1,000 lost their lives. And as was mentioned, they weren't done yet. After the war, a number of 10th Mountain veterans returned to Colorado to build our ski and outdoor industries. Theirs is an extraordinary story, a deeply Colorado story, I think, Mr. President, of service, of vision, entrepreneurship, and of abiding connection to the outdoors and our public lands. And generations later, young veterans from Iraq and Afghanistan took up the fight to memorialize what the 10th Mountain Division did here. I remember sitting with them just up the road in Leadville, one after another of these young veterans told me about the power of these mountains and our public lands and this place to help heal their own wounds of war more than any medication or any treatment, and to find connection not only to nature but to the legacy of the 10th Mountain Division. Those veterans joined so many Coloradans who spent years working to protect this special place. Many are here today, Mr. President, local officials, sportsmen, environmental groups, and many others. This proclamation reflects their vision and their compromises hammered out over literally hundreds of meetings year after year. And the result is a victory for Colorado's environment, our $10 billion outdoor recreation economy, and the legacy of public lands we owe the next generation, a legacy we've burnished over the past 10 years in our state, protecting places like Hermosa Creek and Chimney Rock and Browns Canyon, working with so many of you here. Let me end by acknowledging those who are no longer here, the 10th Mountain veterans who gave their lives in the war, who have passed on since. With this designation, Mr. President, you offer their service the dignity of public remembrance. You safeguard this place and its history, not only for them, but for America. And you ensure that years from now, we can bring our grandkids here and tell them the story of the 10th Mountain Division and their contributions not only to Colorado, but to humanity. And for that, Mr. President, Colorado will be forever grateful. Thank you. And now it's my honor to introduce a great friend and a great partner, Scott Fitzwilliams, the Forest Supervisor of the White River National Forest. I think he's the hardest working person in show business. Thank you.
Thank you. Just you and I now.
Thank you, Senator. You know, I grew up in the heartland of the farmlands of Wisconsin. My dad was a cop. My mom was taking care of me and my five siblings, chasing us around the house. Growing up, life was about sports, camping, fishing, hiking. For us, the outdoors meant everything. But I didn't know I could make a career out of it until I came here to Colorado for graduate school and earned my master's degree in environmental policy. It was there I got an internship with the Forest Service, and I just loved it. So I joined on full time. And for the next 31 years, I got to serve in some of the most amazing, stunning places in America: Alaska, Wyoming, Oregon, Montana, and North Dakota. And then in late 2009, I came back here to Colorado. And for the last 13 years, I've been the Forest Supervisor of this incredible place and the 2.5 million acre White River National Forest. For me and my awesome team, our job is to protect the lands for future generations so that our forests can provide what Americans really want: clean water, clean air, wildlife, recreation, and economic opportunities. It's getting windy. I've considered other positions elsewhere, but I've stayed here because I love this land and I love the people in it. You can feel the energy of these communities. We've all been bonded and shared love and respect for the forests around us, and they provide us nourishment, both physical and spiritual. You know, at the end of a stressful week, I can go fishing, hiking, skiing, backpacking, hunting. It's like nowhere else on earth, and it inspires me every day. These landscapes have been telling us stories for a long time, stories that I continue to learn from our tribal elders, and that I'll pass on to my son. Designating Camp Hale and the surrounding landscape as a national monument marks the next chapter in our story. And so I am honored to introduce the man that who has made it all possible, the leader on climate we can trust, the president who believes in the story of our nation, the story of America the Beautiful. Please welcome President Joe Biden.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. This one working?
Hello, hello, hello.
Not working, is it? It is. Can you hear me?
All right. Well, by the way, I wanted to come out here because I love being in Colorado. I love being in the West. I love even being in Alaska. One of the things I was saying earlier to some of the folks that we came over with is that one of the great treasures we have are our national forests, our national parks. And from the time my kids were old enough to travel with me, I've taken them to almost every national park in the country, down the Colorado, down the Snake River, or just everywhere, because I wanted them to see. I wanted them to see what so many people don't get to see. But folks, I want to thank Scott for the introduction and mostly for his service. You're right, this is the story of America the Beautiful. The way you talk about being a forest ranger is you just can feel the power in this place when you talk about it. And as you just heard, you have the same way of these incredible leaders around you thanking you. Governor Polis, Joe, I tell you what, I didn't know that former governor had worked for you. But Joe from the House and John and Michael, all of you have been determined over the years to protect this sacred and historic lands. And Michael came over here. I want Michael to come back up here a second. Come on, Michael. And the reason why I do, I want you to tell you what happened here. This guy, he made this finally happen, at least me signing this shortly. And he came to the White House, and he said, I told you what I need. And I said, I'll do it. You know why? I was worried he'd never leave the damn White House if he didn't go. And I'm also honored to be joined by several tribal leaders here, because this is your progeny, this magnificent land. You've been great stewards of these sacred lands, but I just want you to know, the reason why he's an environmentalist, he married one. Otherwise, he'd sleep alone. So I just want you to know that. Look, it's great to be with Tom Vilsack, Secretary of Agriculture, Brenda Malloy, a chair of our Council of Environmental Quality. And while she couldn't be here today, especially want to thank our first Native American, who is a cabinet member, Deb Holland, who is the Secretary of Interior. Folks, as I said, when I served as Senator and Vice President, Jill and I made sure to take our children and grandchildren to national parks all around the country. They're treasures and wonders that define the identity of us as a nation. They're a birthright that we pass down from generation to generation, and they unite us. And that's what today is all about. We're doing it not just for today, but for all the ages. And it's for the people of Colorado, but it also goes well beyond the people of Colorado. It's for all the people across America and the world. It's a permanent decision. An action that no future president can overturn. In 1906, President Theodore Roosevelt first used the Antiquities Act to designate a national monument. He essentially invented the national parks. Since then, presidents of both parties have used the Antiquities Act to preserve America's natural treasures, from the Grand Canyon to the Statue of Liberty, to Colorado's canyons of the ancients. Today, we're the authorities under the Antiquities Act. I'm establishing Camp Hale Continental Divide National Monument today. This is the first new national monument of my presidency under this authority. When you think about the national beauty of Colorado and the history of our nation, you find it here. More than 50,000 acres, including the 10-mile range, soaring peaks and steep canyons, black bears, bald eagles, moose, mountain lions, waterfalls, pristine rivers, alpine lakes, a scant in the scent of wildflowers at the right time of the year, and a stunning backdrop of ski slopes and iconic trails. These treasured lands tell the story of America. For thousands of years, tribal nations have been stewards of this sacred land, hunting game, foraging for medicinal plants, and maintaining a deep spiritual bond with the land itself. But by the 1800s, mining activity and federal government drove out indigenous tribes from their homes. but those tribes continue to use these sacred lands. Last year, I issued a historic proclamation officially designating Indigenous Peoples Day to honor the contributions of Native Americans to our society and acknowledge the history of violence committed against them. 2 days ago, we observed that day in this nation. Today, I'll be signing a proclamation to preserve these sacred tribal grounds as a national monument. I was also aware the U.S. Army, as you've already heard, first and only mountain infantry division trained to take on the Nazis in World War II. The 10th Mountain Division, stationed on the valley floor surrounded by rugged boulders, forest, mountains stretching 14,000 feet high, among the tallest mountains in America, facing high altitudes and harsh terrain, deep snow, bitter cold. Soldiers of Camp Hale learned to scale rock, ski, and survive, preparing for the war they were about to fight. The pivotal moment came, as the senator pointed out, in February 1945. A surprise Allied attack in the mountains in Italy. Imagine, it's pitch black, punishing cold. The mission, high in the mountains, that hinged on the skill, strength, and stamina that could have only been gained in a place like this. They're more than ready. They were more than ready that day and since then. American soldiers of the 10th Mountain Division scaled that 1,800-foot cliff at night, caught the Germans by surprise, captured key positions, and broke through the German defense line at a pivotal point in the war. Just imagine, I mean it sincerely, I say this as a father of a man who won the Bronze Star, the Conspicuous Service Medal, and lost his life in Iraq. Imagine the courage, the daring, and the genuine sacrifice they all made. After the war ended, Camp Hale became the hub for innovation in winter warfare. And even when it closed in 1965, many veterans returned to the area. Some became scientists who studied rock glaciers, endangered animals, and wetland forests. Many returned to heal their wounds, both visible and invisible, seeking the solace and sovereign and serenity in ways that only nature can do. Other veterans returned to build world-famous ski resorts, as you all know, and outdoor recreational industries to define Colorado today. Industries that support millions of American jobs, generating hundreds of billions of dollars for our economy, and provide countless, countless memories for families. I taught my boys to ski here. I taught my family to ski here. And by the way, as you all know, especially for us Easterners, we talk about that at dinner. I'm serious. All those memories that you all understandably take for granted, they're a big deal where I come from. Today, as Commander-in-Chief, it's a true honor to be joined by two of the few surviving veterans of the original 10th Mountain Division. Francis Lovett. Francis, where's Francis? He's going to come up later. Francis, as my mother would say, God love you, man. God love you. 100 years young, enlisted in the Army at age 20, stationed at Camp Hale, fought overseas, earned 2 Bronze Stars, and among many other medals, a war hero who came home to become a teacher and a principal. Thank you, Francis, for your service to our country and all you've done to get this monument designated. Thank you. He's also joined by another 10th Mountain Division man, a guy named Robert Scheuer. 99 years young, trained at this camp, served his country before joining his dad's business just a few years ago. He came back to Colorado to be with his family. Robert, thank you for your service. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And I'm honored to sign this proclamation to preserve a special part of our military history. In addition, Secretary Vilsack just explained, today my administration is announcing steps to conserve the Thompson Divide, another 225,000 acres, 60 miles from here. It's another congressional priority for Michael, John, and Joe. We're standing with Colorado's farmers, ranchers, hunters, anglers, who have forged generations to protect beautiful streams, aspen groves, and the Thompson Divide area. But let me be clear. There's no current or planned oil exploration production in the area. We're just keeping things as they've been for a long time for the next 20 years while we study, for the next years while we study whether we can get this done. In my first year in office, I protected more lands and waters than any American president since John Kennedy. After the previous administration rolled back protections, I restored full protection to three national monuments in Utah and New England. And I signed and designated the Amachi Japanese incarceration camp of World War II as a national historic site in southeastern Colorado. We purchased additional land at Sand Creek massacre site outside of Denver. And we did, and by the way, I'm not sure I would have understood how important this was had I not gotten to see these parks until I understood the breathtaking nature of it. To stand there on the edge of a cliff in the Rio Grande to, you know, looking at one thing, and it's just, there's not many cliffs, but then head up to the Grand Canyon. It's a cathedral. It takes your breath away. I've climbed it from the river up, and I've looked at it from the top down. It's breathtaking. And I don't think till you see some of these things, do you understand why it was so important to continue to preserve. And with the help of a member of Congress here today, I signed the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law and the Inflation Reduction Act that constitute the largest investment in climate ever in history, the history of the world. We're investing billions of dollars to protect our iconic outdoors, preserve our historic sites, and address the devastating influx of climate change. It includes historic funding for farmers and communities in the upper and lower Colorado River Basin so they can conserve water during the droughts. It includes historic investments in communities across Colorado to recover and build from devastating wildfires. And by the way, to all the Forest Service and the firefighters, we owe you big. I've traveled just in the last 2 years over every major wildfire in America in a helicopter. You realize more land has burned to the ground than occupies the entire state of New Jersey, the entire state of New Jersey, from New Mexico to Washington State to Idaho, across the entire West. It's devastating. And there's so much more we have to do. There's more that we have to do that really matters. Let me close with this. Edward Abbey, a writer who once worked as a ranger in the Arches National Park in Utah, wrote, and I quote, "There are many such places. Every man, every woman carries in his heart and mind the image of the ideal place, the right place, the one true home, known or unknown, actual or visionary." We're just such a place here today. And thanks to Michael Bennett, I now ask everyone who has worked so hard to help make this happen to please join me as we sign this official proclamation declaring Camp Hale Continental Divide National Monument. God bless you all. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you all for fighting for this. I really mean it.
Like it.
All right.
Now, where do you want to go?
Wherever
right
you
there.
Want to go. You go right there.
Right here. And I'm going to turn you around and you're going to sit down. Okay. Yeah. Okay, let go. I got you. No, you stay put. Oh, you're going to turn around?
Oh, gentlemen, I signed this in your honor, in the honor of all the warriors you fought with. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Says the title, Establishment of Camp Hale, Continental Divide National Monument by the President of the United States of America, Proclamation.